Hello everyone. This is the first video on the clock reaction experiment. Now this experiment actually has several goals. In this video, we would focus on goal number one, which is to determine the rate law of the target reaction shown below. Iodide plus bromate plus proton producing some products. Now the general form of the rate law would be rate equals K, the rate constant, times the concentration of each reactant raised to its order. The goal is to determine the rate constant and the order with respect to each reactant. As we learn lecture, one way to calculate these values is by using the method of initial rates. Recall that this means we must do the following. 1. We must measure the initial rates for the target reaction in multiple trials. 2. In each trial, we change one of the reactant's concentration to see what effect that has on the reaction rate. For example, if the rate is doubled when the reactant concentration is doubled, then the reactant must be first order. 3. Once we obtain the orders for all reactants, we can use them to determine the rate constant. If you check in the lab procedure for this experiment, you will see table 1, which shows 4 trials where in each trial you will mix some proportion of the 3 reactants, exactly as we will need for the method of initial rates. Now, clearly another important component of the method of initial rates is a way to measure initial rate in each trial. Let's discuss how to do this. First, remember that rate is defined as the negative of the change in reactant concentration divided by the change in time. Since we have 3 reactants, in theory, we can choose any reactant to define as our rate. As you remember, once we know the rate with respect to one reactant, we can use stoichiometry to relate it to rate with respect to other reactants. To simplify rate calculation, typically we choose the rate with respect to the reactant with the coefficient of 1. So in this case, we would use bromate. So our rate is then the negative change in bromate concentration over a change in time. This means we must measure bromate concentration at the start of and shortly after the reaction has begun. Unfortunately, as you can see in this picture, bromate is a colorless substance, making visual observation impossible. The good news is that we can instead use the appearance of iodine as a measure of initial rate. The reason is because iodine reacts with starch to produce an intense blue color as shown in the picture. So if we measure the time it takes for the blue color to appear, that is the time for enough iodine to react with starch, it will be related to the initial rate with respect to bromate. There is one issue here, and that is that the target reaction is very fast, in the milliseconds range. Because our reflexes are slower, we won't be able to actually start and stop our timer to record the time in a precise manner. So how can we solve this problem? Well, let's imagine this situation. Let's imagine that you're trying to measure the speed of a runner going from start to finish, and the runner is so fast that as soon as you start your timer, the runner is already at the finish. One way to make the speed measurement possible is by increasing the distance that the runner has to cover from start to finish. The added distance allows more precise measurements of the time and thus a more precise rate. The analogy to the added distance is the addition of the thiosulfate ion, S2O32-. Thiosulfate reacts with iodine to thus removing it from the reaction mixture. If iodine is not present, then the iodine and starch reaction can't take place, and the blue color won't show up. The blue color will appear after all the thiosulfate ion has been consumed. We call thiosulfate our clock reagent, and the thiosulfate iodine reaction the clock reaction, because it functions to help us measure the time for the reaction. So the rate now is defined as the change in thiosulfate concentration over change in time. Now let's say you're trying to compare the speed of 2 very fast runners. Again, we're going to add that distance for both runners. But more importantly, you're going to have to add the same distance. In other words, the added distance must be equal for both runners. Otherwise, a slower runner may appear to be faster if it only has to run a shorter distance. So similarly in our experiment, the concentration of thiosulfate must be constant in each trial so that it doesn't mask the actual rate of the target reaction. So how do we actually calculate our rate then? Remember that the rate that we measure now is the rate of the disappearance of thiosulfate, which we can write as the negative change in thiosulfate concentration over change in time, which is just equal to final minus initial values of each variable. Now let's think about this. What must the final concentration of thiosulfate be when the blue color shows up? That only happens when the thiosulfate is completely gone, so it must be zero based on what we discussed before. Now, what about the initial thiosulfate concentration? Well, we must look at actual values used in the mixture. Notice that in table 1, we see 0.001 molar thiosulfate. That's actually not the initial concentration of thiosulfate. The reason is because the thiosulfate must be mixed with other reagents before the reaction, which therefore dilutes the concentration of the thiosulfate. So to calculate the initial concentration of thiosulfate, we must first use the dilution equation, which is M1V1 equals M2V2. Substituting all these values, we will get M2 equals to 2 times 10 to the minus 4 molar, and that's the initial thiosulfate concentration. If we then substitute these values into the rate equation, we will get that rate with respect to thiosulfate is 2 times 10 to the power of minus 4 molar over change in time. Note that the numerator here stays constant for all trials as we discussed above. However, remember that the reaction's rate is defined with respect to bromate and not thiosulfate. So what we must do is relate the rate with respect to thiosulfate and bring it to the rate with respect to bromate. We can do this through stoichiometry of the species in the target and the clock reactions, as shown below. Now, how do we do this? Well, since every iodine requires 2 thiosulfate and every bromate requires 3 iodine, the rate with respect to bromate is 1/6 the rate with respect to thiosulfate. So substituting the number for the thiosulfate rate that we got earlier to the rate with respect to bromate, we will find that the rate with respect to bromate will be 3.3 times 10 to the power of minus 5 molar over change in time. Lastly, let's say for example, if the time you measure for the blue color to show up is 1 minute 23 seconds, to calculate the rate, you will take 3.3 times 10 to the minus 5 molar and divide that by the time that you have in seconds, which is 83 seconds. And you will get a rate that's equal to 4.02 times 10 to the minus 7 molar per second.